Today we are going to demonstrate some tutorial problem from the part A of this module, which covers lecture 1, lecture 2 and lecture 3. So, the first problem is on Newton's law of viscosity. So, the problem statement is like this. You have two plates. The bottom plate is shown here, the top plate is shown here, and there are two fluids, fluid 1 and fluid 2. The top plate is moved using a force F at a velocity u, and the height of the first layer of fluid, that is fluid 1, is h by 2 till the half of this gap, and the rest is again h by 2. So, for this problem, these are the parameters which are given. The velocity u is given as 1 meter per second, h is 0.5 millimeter, viscosities of the first and second are given, second fluid are given, second layers of fluids are given, 0.1 Pascal second and 0.5 Pascal second. So, the second fluid in this given problem is more viscous than the first one. Area, the bottom area of this plate is 1 meter square. So, what we have to find is what force is required to make the plate move at the given velocity, which is 1 meter per second. And another thing is also given here, we can see that the velocity profile, the velocity variation in the direction perpendicular to the plate is not continuous because of the different viscosities of this fluid. So, there is a change in the gradient of velocity at the interface. What is required is to find out what is the velocity of the interface at the interface. So, let us see how we solve this problem. We have to find out the force for moving the top plate at a velocity of 1 meter per second and also the velocity at the interface. While we discuss, it will be clear why there is a gradient discontinuity at the interface. So, for looking at this, we look at this interface more closely. So, if you look at this interface, the shear stress on both the sides have to be same. There has to be the gradient of velocity can be discontinuous, but the shear stress should be continuous because the shear stress is transferred through the fluid layers. The shear stress transferred at the interface by fluid 1 should be same as the shear stress transferred to the fluid 2, or it is actually reverse. The shear stress transferred by fluid 2 at the interface should be same as the shear stress transferred to fluid 1 at the interface. So, continuity of shear stress is the most important highlight of this particular tutorial problem. So, we make tau 1 as tau 2, tau 1 being the shear stress at the interface for fluid 1, tau 2 is the shear stress at the same point at the interface on the fluid 2 side. So, if you write it in terms of, now if you use Newton's law of viscosity, you can write this as mu 1 du by dy at 1 is equal to mu 2 du by dy at 2. So, you can also see from this expression itself that the gradient discontinuity in the velocity profile, that means the slope of the line in the fluid 1 has to be different from the slope of the line in the fluid 2, because the relationship which has to be maintained is the continuity of the shear stress. So, du by dy at the in the fluid 1 side cannot be equal to du by dy in the fluid 2 side unless mu 1 and mu 2 are equal. So, this is the most important point in this problem, shear stress continuity. In fact, there are a lot of other things which you can also say, like if one of the viscosity is very close to 0, then the velocity gradient could be very small. So, we will not talk about that problem here, but let us say this is a stress continuity condition. Now, by applying this condition, as the profiles are given as linear, we can find out the intermediate velocity first. So, for that mu 1 multiplied by this is basically, for a linear profile you can easily find out the gradient as u interface in the side 1, u interface minus 0 divided by h by 2, and this is u minus u interface divided by h by 2. So, now following this you can find out the value of interface velocity in terms of the velocity of the top plate and the viscosity ratio. So, for the given conditions, if you apply the given condition, the interface velocity is given as 5 by 6 meter per second. for the plate moving at 1 meter per second, this is 5 by 6 meter per second. Okay, so now we can find out the force required. That is quite simple, because the force is basically shear stress into the area. So, the shear stress we already obtained, and the shear stress in any layer is same. The same shear stress is actually transferred from the top plate till the bottom plate. So, anywhere the shear stress is same. So, you can write this as mu 2 into this u minus u in by this, or mu 1 into this, and then you can find out the value of the force required to move this plate at a velocity of 1 meter per second. From this expression, another thing we can comment is that now let us say we saw a situation where, because now we have a parametric relationship between u intermediate and u, we can say what happens when mu 1 is less than mu 2, which is the given case, that viscosity of the fluid 1 is less than the viscosity of fluid 2. Viscosity of fluid 1 is 0.1 and that of 2 is 0.5. So, that means you need a very small change in velocity in fluid 2, because the viscosity is high there, you need a very small change in fluid 2 than compared to the fluid 1. So, the velocity profile will look like this. The velocity of the plate is very close to that at the interface, because the viscosity 2 is high. If you look at mu 1 is equal to mu 2, which is the same fluid condition, of course, then you have just a linear profile like this. You can think about mu 1 being greater than mu 2, that means the lower fluid has a higher viscosity than the fluid at the top, mu 2. Under this condition, you will have a velocity profile as shown here. That means for a given value of u int, which also means that the given value of shear stress, because see, of course, if the viscosity is, if we keep mu 1 same, and if we reduce the value of mu 2 for the same shear stress, now you have to, what it means is you have to move the plate at a higher velocity. You cannot move the plate at 1 meter per second and get an u int, required u int for generating this shear force. You need to move it, which is of course understandable, because high viscous fluid can transfer shear stresses more effectively. If 2 is less, viscosity of the second fluid is less, it cannot transfer shear stress so effectively. So, this is the first tutorial. The second problem is about velocity profile in a boundary layer. So, we have introduced boundary layer while talking about the difference between viscous and an inviscid flow. It is the region within which the viscous effects are important. Now, let us say the velocity profile in a boundary layer is given as this, u y, u is a function of y, it is given as a plus b into y by delta plus c into y by delta cube. Delta is basically the thickness of the boundary layer. So, this changes, as we can see here, this changes if we move along the plate. So, let us say you have this cubic profile. The question is, can we find out a, b and c, this three constant? So, in some sense this is also related to two concepts, application of the no slip boundary condition and Newton's law of viscosity. So, no slip boundary condition, of course, first thing is we can say from no slip we make u 0 as the velocity of the plate. The plate is not moving here, so it is 0. So u 0 is 0, and you can immediately, if you plug in the value of y, so the y is equal to 0 here, you get immediately a is equal to 0. The second condition is from the free stream condition. What is the free stream condition? It has to match the velocity in the free stream. Free stream means the velocity at which the fluid is coming towards the plate. So it should have the same velocity at the edge of the boundary layer. So if you apply that condition, what you get is u at delta is equal to this. So that means b plus c is u. A is already 0 from the first condition, b plus c is equal to u. The third condition is the more interesting condition. You have to apply a zero shear at the boundary layer edge. The edge of the boundary layer should have a shear stress, zero shear stress. Why is that? Because after the boundary layer, it is inviscid. There is no shear stress transferred to from inside to outside the boundary layer. So shear stress has to be zero here. If the shear stress is 0, by applying Newton's law of viscosity, what we can say, the gradient of velocity is 0. Mu into du by dy at y is equal to delta should be 0. Mu cannot be 0, so du by dy at y is equal to delta is 0. If you apply that condition, you get a third condition, b plus 3c is equal to 0. Now you can solve between these two equations, you can get the values of a, b and c. So this problem demonstrates how to apply the boundary conditions like no slip, free stream condition and zero shear condition to a velocity profile. So the velocity profile will look like this for the situation, for this situation, for the given conditions. We will demonstrate a third problem. So this third problem is related to the flow, the concept of flow visualization, stream lines and path lines. So let us consider this velocity field. This velocity field, so now from our explanation of the velocity field, we can tell here that this is a two-dimensional velocity field. Because why is that? Because the z direction velocity is 0, and not only that, the x and y direction velocity are independent of z. So given that this velocity field is a two-dimensional velocity field, and it is an unsteady field because it changes with time, it reduces as the both the x component and y component velocity reduces as time increases. Now the problem is find the equation of a streamline passing through the point 1 comma 0.5 at different times, and also find the equation of the path line passing through the same point at t is equal to 1 second. So as we had seen that a streamline actually changes for an unsteady flow, but this is a very special situation. We will see what happens here. We have to find the streamline passing through this point at different times. So x component, like we saw here, the x component of flow, the flow velocity is x by t, y component is minus y by t. Equation we have to write by streamline, we have to write an equation of a line tangent to the velocity vector. So if we take the ratio of this two, vy by vx, it should give the slope of the streamline at a location. So dy by dx is basically the slope of the streamline at x comma y, which you can get by just dividing vy by vx, and you see something interesting, that t disappears. So dy by dx is independent of t. So even though the velocity, it is an unsteady field, the streamlines does not change, because this is for this situation it does not change with time. So now we can easily find equation of the streamline passing through the point 1 comma 0.5. This can be integrated, it is dy by y dx by x. If you take it together, it comes out to be dy by y plus dx by x is equal to 0. Integrating that, you can get x y is equal to constant, and you can ascertain the value of the constant. by plugging in this values through which that streamline passes. The streamline passes through 0.1, 0.5, you plug in these values here, you get 0.05. So, that means xy is equal to 0.05 is the equation of this streamline. So, the point to demonstrate here is that in this situation, even if the flow is unsteady, the streamline does not change with time. So, for path line, we can see from here how to get the equation of a path line from the Eulerian velocity field. Like we had demonstrated, that Eulerian velocity field means the velocity at a particular point, not of a particle. So, for path line, we can say that Vx is equal to, we can write it as dx by dt. So, basically any particle passing through that point will have the same velocity at as that particular point. So, dx by dt of that particle will be given as x by t, dy by dt will be given as minus y by t. So, if we can integrate these two equations, we should be able to get the equation of the path line. So, if you do that, you get x by t is equal to constant and y t is equal to constant. So, if you look at the equation of the path line, again by using this two, it is the same, x y is equal to 0.05. Of course, this is understandable, because if the streamlines are not changing with time, the particle or any particle introduced at a point has no other choice than to follow the streamline, because perpendicular to the streamline there is no flow. So, it has to follow the streamlines only. So, the things which are demonstrated in this problem are that even though the Eulerian flow field is unsteady, streamline do not change with time, and streamline and path line coincide with each other. So, this is the diagram which demonstrate the streamlines, all the streamlines for this flow field, for this particular flow field, and the line marked in red shows the specific streamline which is asked for in this problem, that is xy is equal to 0.05. So, with this we come to the end of part A of the first module of this course. In the next part, that is part B, we will start with the integral analysis of fluid flow. Thank you.